Welcome, everyone. We're happy you're here. My name is Farhan, and we're gonna have a beautiful program for you, starting with Shahrazad from Seattle. And they're gonna have dances for you from Morocco, and enjoy. Thank you for coming.
Asma. Can you hear us, Asma? Yeah, you'll get to know one another.
Now?
Yes, go ahead, Layla.
Hi, everybody. Hi, Asma. Hi, Layla. I'm happy to meet you here online. And so I'm Layla. I'm originally from Iran, and I immigrated to the United States in the year 2000. But since my immigration, and before that, I have been a political activist, a social justice activist, and I'm really connected into events in Middle East, and unfortunately the impact of US militarization of the region. I've been following it and suffering from it. And it's very unfortunate. But I understand you are from Palestine. And I visited Palestine in the year 2009. And I am and I was privileged to working with many Palestinian peace and justice organization, and I really learned a lot from them.
And Asma, could you share with yourself and those that are here at the Days of Listening at the Rachel Corey Arab Fest in Olympia a little bit about yourself? There are many people here that have not met you, but would like to get to know a little bit about you and about what you're doing in Gaza.
Hi, I'm Asma. I'm from Palestine, Gaza. I'm very happy to be here with you. Although I won't be able to be here for long. I'm an English language teacher, and I'm also an interpreter with UNICEF. I actually started working with UNICEF this week. I'm a little bit, I don't know if I can call myself a human rights activist, but I'm kind of really interested in human rights, especially after what the people in Gaza have been subjected to for the past few years. I mean, 2008, 2009, 2012, and the recent aggression 2014. So, that's pretty much it.
We don't have very long, so let's see. Asma and Layla, there are several people here listening. One I met this morning, Fred.
Yeah.
Should you have either questions or something? Yes, you do?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. For Asma and
yes,
Gaza,
sure.
Yes. Can you move up a little
sure.
bit?
Yeah,
use this so that she can hear you through the microphone that's in the computer. And Asma, this is Fred, who does have a question. Go ahead.
My question is, how are people coping now in Gaza after the bombings and so much destruction? How are people living in the middle of all the destruction? And are you safe?
Hello?
Are you safe where you are?
Hello. People are not really coping very well in here. Some displaced people are still living in UNRWA shelters with very low access to services. And things are peaceful now. You know, they've been peaceful for the past 2 months after the last ceasefire. And today is a very important religious celebration for Muslims. Adha. People have been celebrating since this morning, and people are trying to cope with the situation, but from what I see here, they're not coping very well. And yes, I am safe now. Thank you.
Thank you.
Asma, please pass along the wishes from the Global Days listeners and the team to your family and your friends that we will continue to keep you in our thoughts, our prayers, and that we look forward to sharing your voice and the real story of what's happening on the ground in the days, weeks to come.
Happy Eid.
And that was from Dennis. Yes.
Oh, hey, my friend is back. How are you doing, Mesa? Let's get you mic'd up here. Did you do any more coloring yet?
Yes.
How was that?
What?
How was that? Was it fun?
Yeah.
Did you color the ice cream cone you were telling us about earlier? Do you want to show the audience here your craft? Yeah, round of applause. Check it out. Beautiful work. We have plenty of children's activities right over here by the entrance. You can see Elizabeth. Raise your hand, Elizabeth. Let them know you're here. Woo! We have coloring, mosaic crafts, glue little shapes on paper, simulate Arab art with construction paper, and wonderful things all over the place. We have games also, some chess, backgammon. But right now we're ready for drumming, I think. I think it's time for a little tabla drumming.
Today I'm here to give you guys a small little, I don't want to necessarily call it a lecture, but I'm going to be talking about Arabic music and Arabic instrumentation based on percussion today. So I won't be playing any other instruments, but just percussion. So first off, my name is Wasim, as you guys know. I am a Palestinian, Lebanese, Egyptian, and a percussionist as well, Seattle-based. So I play with the MB Orchestra as well as the Jafra Depka team. So today I'm just gonna give you guys some demos and some history about the instrumentation that I have here in front of me, as well as what their roles are in Arabic music. So first off, I'm gonna start off with this instrument called a rik. So if you guys can pronounce that word, rik. Rik. Rik, there you go. Just like Rick, but not Rick. Yeah, it's like a heavy like K. All right. So this instrument right here is the first and original like percussion instrument in Arabic music bands, which are called like taht shari. And this instrument originally is made out of wood and like animal skins. In this case, this actually is made out of wood still. This skin that you see right here as the playing surface is made out of like a synthetic skin or plastic a lot of the time nowadays. So it kind of looks like an American like Western tambourine, like very similar. It's part of the same family, but like, you know, we don't play it the same. It's a different playing style. And this used to be the main instrument in Arabic bands. This used to be the main percussive instrument. You didn't have any other instruments along with it. It was mainly this one. But of course times have changed and this has been, I don't want to say replaced, but a lot of the time you don't have these in the bigger bands because there's more electronics involved. You know, there's more keyboards, there's more big percussion like these guys right here. So it's harder to hear it. It's a very intricate, delicate instrument. So I'm going to give you guys a quick little demo. Actually first, when it comes to rhythms, the word for rhythms in Arabic is iqa. So if you guys can say the word iqa. And then plural, as in like multiple rhythms, is ika'at. Ika'at. Yeah. It's kind of difficult. So I'm going to give you guys a quick little demo of the rik real quick, and then we'll move on to some more stuff. So with a lot of these instruments, you're going to get some main sounds, some main syllables that stay the same throughout. So for the rit, we have the bass sound, the doom, which is going to be on the other drums too. So you have a... So that's the bass sound. That's what kind of is the backbone that holds the rhythm. Also with this, we have zills on the sides, metal jingles. So these are just kind of to add little ornamentations for the rhythm. So if I'm playing like a rhythm, So it just adds like a little bit of flavor to it. There's two ways of playing the rit. You have the classical style, which is for, you know, accompanying like stringed instruments to stay more quiet. So it's, you know, so it's very delicate, it's more quiet, and it's more dampened in the sound. And then you have a style called the cabaret style, which is more upright, and that's mainly for like louder movements in the music, so, you know, and it's for shaking movements, so. So that's kind of the purpose of this instrument right here. So I'm gonna give you guys like an actual like demo, play some rhythms real quick, some old rhythms that are played within Arabic music, old styles as well, so. Just a very short, quick demo of what this instrument can do. Just a very, very few sounds on this. So moving on to the next instrument, which normally throws people for a loop if they don't know anything about it, classical Arabic music, is the bongos. So a lot of people are thinking, like, why did this guy bring bongos? In all actuality, bongos have been in old classical Arabic music for a long time, since the days of, like, if you've seen like Umm Kulthum's band, for those who might listen to old Arabic music, they've had bongo players in the past. So, just a traditional set of bongos. You know, what you see in a lot of Cuban and Latin music as well. Basically what bongos are good for, especially in Latin music as well as Arabic music, is to add more flavor on top of the beat. It holds the beat, but adds flavor, kind of like, you know, seasoning to the you know, the ingredients. So I'll give you guys a quick demo kind of the bongos real quick and some Arabic rhythms on the bongos as well. So just a simple demo. The thing that's great about Arabic music and just music in general is it's its own language. It's very global. You know, there's a lot of rhythms, for example, that can be played on the bongos that are played in Arabic music. You know, for example, there's a rhythm called, what we have is, we have a rhythm called malfouf that sounds like something like this. So it's like. But for example, like there's another rhythm more in Latin music called the habanera or soca, for example, that sounds like this. Both of these rhythms correspond with each other very well. They go over each other, you know, whenever you're playing like, you know, a malfouf rhythm. You could play the other rhythm over it. So yeah, music is very much its own language and it's very unifying. So last but not least, I'm gonna show you guys my main instrument and probably my most favorite instrument in Arabic percussion. And this instrument right here is called a dumbek or darbuka or derbeki or tabla. It depends on where you're from because it's all about dialect. So the name of this drum will change and differ throughout which region that you are in. So this drum is actually the drum that I take when I travel most of the time. The traditional ones now are made out of aluminum with mother of pearl inlays with a plastic playing surface. But the original ones actually had clay bodies or wood bodies with animal skin as the playing surface. This one's actually made by the American drum company Remo, which is kind of funny. And this body is made out of wood, composite wood. It's like recycled wood, good for the environment, so that's always good. The rim is actually made out of carbon fiber. It's like a plastic. And the playing surface is plastic as well. So it actually turned out pretty good. And then this one, of course, you know, you have your, you know, colors and designs. They're all different. They all sound different. It just kind of depends on, you know, where you get it and who makes it. So with this drum, it's very similar to the rit with within its syllables. And I'll show you guys the sounds it makes. So this drum is also going to have a bass sound, which is going to sound like this. And then also it's going to have its accent sound, which is called a sec. It's like a slap. So instead of letting the drum resonate, you just slap it, and it just gives it like an accent, a different flavor. And there's different slaps. You know, you have... Depending on how you move your hand, you get different accents with the notes. And then also there's the high-end notes. There's the techs and the cos, which add to the rhythm that you're trying to make. So there's the techs with the right hand. And you're basically hitting on the edge of the drum to produce a high-end treble sound. Then you have your cos, which is with your ring finger. What you do is you use your ring finger in the motion of a whip, and you come down. So as you can imagine, if you're trying to make a rhythm, you put that all together and it's like... So that's kind of like, you know, kind of what the end product sounds like with these drums. So I will give you like a full actual like demo of this right now, and you guys feel free to clap, enjoy yourselves, and we'll get to it. So. Thank you. Thank you guys very much for having me. Thank you for being here. And I appreciate you here celebrating the Arabic culture. Thank you very much.
We know you. dance with you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
اليوم لازم تقولي
اليوم لازم تقولي
يا حسرة غيبي عليه
اليوم لازم تقولي
يا حسرة غيبي عليه.
Sykes-Picot is Sykes-Picot was basically a deal that was made between Sykes, who was the British authority. This is at the end of the Ottoman Empire, which fell in 1921. Remember that now? At the end of 1921. And at that time, the Europeans had been, really had a colonizing presence in the Middle East since the late 19th century. And so there was a secret, there were a bunch of deals made once the Ottoman Empire fell. On one hand, the British said to the Arabs in the peninsula, in the Arabian Peninsula, what is now Saudi Arabia and the Gulf states, hey, we'll make a deal with you, and we, you know, the Turks are oppressing you, stand up for your independence, because of course the British were fighting the Turks at that time, the Ottomans. Stand up for your independence, if you claim your independence, then we will back you. And so this is where the story of Lawrence of Arabia comes up if you're interested, right? So that was one thing happening. And then at the very same time, the British are making a deal with the Zionists, right? Who, since the late 19th century, have slowly been immigrating, the Jewish, European Jews, have been immigrating to Palestine, and then that number grew dramatically after the Holocaust. Okay, so at the same time, you know, the British are making that deal, and then at the same time, it's quite amazing. They also made a deal with their French counterpart Picot. I don't know his first name. Sykes is the British, Picot is the French. They got together and they made a deal that they actually just took out a world map. And got out a ruler. I mean, there's this mythology about the ruler, you know, and just drew lines and said, all right, you're going to take this and you're going to take that, and we're going to split up Syria and create Lebanon. The French said this to protect the Christians in Lebanon. And the British are going to have indirect rule over Egypt and take the cotton and oil wealth, and et cetera. Saudi's going to be British, and then Iraq is going to be British. And So this actually happened. It was only exposed later by Lenin, actually, who was trying to get the Arabs to turn to the Soviet bloc.
This next piece is a song by Muhammad Abdel Wahab called Yom Sefer.
Mm-hmm.